Want to send out some prayers to Cecil Hurt. He is currently in the hospital dealing with pneumonia. It's not COVID. It is pneumonia. So for anybody that listens to us, he's been on the show with us multiple times. One of my friends as well. But yes, he's dealing with it right now, going through some stuff, and is still in the hospital. He is not covering Alabama currently because of that. So you have not seen much Twitter activity or anything else, hadn't read any bylines from him, and that would be the reason why. So hopefully he heals up and he can get back in plenty of time to watch the end of the season. We'll see what happens with that, but definitely prayers with Cecil. The college football off the radar pick'em. We are going to do this for week 11. Last week, I went 6-6. Chris went 5-7 on the season. I am 52-55. Chris is 44-63. Let's see. So what, did those numbers add up? That doesn't seem right. No, it adds up. Okay, we're good. Never mind. Let's start off game number one. Game number one, we are going to Auburn, Alabama. Mississippi State is taking on the Tigers, and Auburn is a 5.5-point favorite, total of 50. Odds, of course, brought to you by BetUS. Last year, Auburn won this game 24-10. State is 5-1 against the spread of their last six on the road. Auburn 5-1 straight up their last six against Mississippi State. And they are 4-1 against the spread in the last five against State. So when you look at this matchup, I think State gave everything they had last week. It is very difficult to go on the road and do it two times in a row. I think Auburn gets up off the mat after going to College Station. Weird stuff happens in Jordan-Hare, even in the early games. I like Auburn here. I like Auburn minus 5.5. I think they are still a really good football team. State, every now and then, has those clunkers that you just don't understand from them. It all depends on whether or not Will Rogers is having a good game, and he is a fantastic quarterback. But if he is not hitting on all cylinders, that team has no shot. So I'm going to take Auburn to cover the 5.5. I think they could do that even if Will Rogers plays really well. What you got on this one?
Yeah, I like Auburn. I think Auburn needs one little bit of help and A&M to slip and fall somewhere. And if they do, then Auburn still controls their destiny. So of winning the SEC West and making it to Atlanta. So I'm going to pick them. I think they get back to their winning ways. And I think they're a really good team. This year, there were two guys the entire country was just dead wrong on. I was wrong on one of them, Brian Harsin and
yeah, those two. And I'll toss in a player there, Bo Nix. He didn't play well last week.
Well, Bo Nix.
But
that's right. No, that's Bo Nix is, that defense just did exactly what we thought they would do, right? Stop him from running 75 yards left and right. And keep him in a pocket, make him throw the football, and you can beat him. But I don't know that there are many defenses outside of Georgia in the SEC or in the rest of the country that actually have the ability to do that.
Yeah, I think A&M and Georgia are the two best defenses.
I don't think Mississippi State's defense has the ability. I think he will be running back and forth, making wild-ass plays on the plane, just like he did against LSU, just like he did against Ole Miss, just like he did against Arkansas, just pulling a rabbit out of his hat. This is what this guy does.
I tend to agree. Moving on to the ACC now. Syracuse at Louisville is the next one up. It's a 12 p.m. Eastern time game. Louisville, a 3-point favorite. 55.5 is the total here. And the Cuse, 5-0 against the spread in their last five. 6-1 against the spread their last seven on the road. Louisville, 5-0 against the spread their last five against Syracuse. However, that stretches out not over the last, five seasons. When I look at this, and I look at that Louisville team, I don't know how much is left in the tank with Louisville. Syracuse looks really good right now. I'm going to side with Dino. I'm going to do the Dino drop here and absolutely take Syracuse to win this game outright. So if I'm catching three, I'm certainly going to take that because I think Syracuse is the better overall football team. Their defense has really showed up lately. I like them. I like them a lot. So I'm going to roll with Syracuse.
I don't know why something has happened this year where I have just fallen in love with Louisville and I can't quit them. I don't know that I've won a bet on them in a long, long time, but I like watching them play. I haven't seen a player. I mean, I'm not saying this because he's playing at the same school and he plays the same position and he looks like him. I haven't seen a player that kind of captivated me the way Cunningham has since Lamar. I really haven't. Like, I don't have any ties to Louisville. I don't have any reason to have an
emotional attachment to him
one way or the other from them. But I just love watching this kid play football, man. I watch him carry this team, and I kind of see these other guys following him, and they're trying. I just don't think they have the talent, but they got the talent to hang with Syracuse. Okay, they're more talented than Syracuse, in my opinion. I think they're the better team. I love Dino. I'm riding with Louisville. You know, I would say ride or tussie butcher. You don't ride at all. Hell, she doesn't nothing but butcher. Maybe she'll let me ride a little bit here.
I like it. All right, so you are going to ride Louisville minus the 3. I've got the Cuse. Next game on the board here, we have got an AAC game. And that AAC game would be 12 p.m. Eastern time, UCF at SMU. And I don't quite understand it, but SMU is a 7-point favorite, total of 60.5. UCF 5-0 straight up their last 5 against SMU. SMU 5-0 against the spread their last 5 at home. You start digging into some of these numbers. Yeah, if you just want to take the full season, then okay. And I understand that that's where the majority of these lines come from.
Hey, hang on.
Go ahead.
Wait a minute. You're okay with looking back years, but you're not okay with looking at the season that we're in right now. You like roll your eyes at that. Well, okay, I guess. If you want to look at what we've done this year, then I guess it makes sense. But
there's a lot.
When Grandpa played and SMU was like, what are we talking about? Have we lost our minds?
There's
Am I crazy?
This my brain is all over the place on these games. Okay,
yeah,
because
that's an understatement.
I look at these trends, and you can see these trends, right? I mean, it follows across the board because you see teams like West Virginia that can never beat Oklahoma State for whatever reason, but they seem to always beat TCU. I mean, you start looking back at these certain trends, right? UCF being a 5, like beating this team 5 straight times, and now they are a 7-point dog. I get it, right? I understand, because if you look at the full season for UCF, but you don't take into account the fact that they lost their quarterback after week 2 or 3 or whatever it was, and then Mikey Keene was pretty bad.
Why would we take that into account, Gary? Why would we? Huh?
Right. Hold on. Right? Here's what I'm getting at, right? Because I've started, and I'm doing better this season because I've started looking more at a trend over the last 3 games as opposed to a full season. Because as we know, college football is a living organism. It continues to evolve. Teams can improve throughout the season. SMU, over the last couple of weeks, has looked really bad. Really bad. And I don't know if that has anything to do with Sonny Dykes and the TCU talk, or his contract talk, or whatever, or if SMU was just selling us a bill of goods, you know, early in the season. I don't know what happened. So I do wonder here. Because I think UCF's pretty good. Like, Mikey Keene has figured this thing out with Gus Malzahn's offense. I think we're going to see some points. I think we're going to see a lot of fun plays here. I'm going to take UCF plus the 7 here. I don't know that they'll win the game outright, but if you give me a head start with a team that I think is just as good as the other one, yeah, give me the Knights.
That's fine. Look, we're going to go the same way. We
just took a different path to get there.
No, that's an understood. What you took is not a path, sir. What you took is not a path. You just, I can't explain it. But
I went off-road with a golf cart.
I'll take the point. Okay. I'll take the point, and that's it.
Okay, I can understand. Right. Let's move to the ACC again. Boston College, 3:30 p.m. Eastern time. Boston College headed to Georgia Tech. And the Ramblin' Wreck are a 2-point favorite. 54.5 is the total. Last season, BC won this game 48-27. Phil Jurkovic, or however you want to say his name, I believe it's Jurkovic, he is back. He did not look great last week against Virginia Tech. However, that did build up Boston College quite a bit. They stopped Virginia Tech, held them to only 3 points, and obviously Braxton Burmeister went out in that game. That certainly hurt. BC 3-6 against the spread their last 9 games on the road, so they don't play well on the road. But Jurkovic has been out for a long period of time here. So Georgia Tech 4-5 against the spread at home over the last 2 seasons. They are 1-3 in that role this season. When I look at these numbers, on this team or on these teams this year, Georgia Tech has, I mean, they're really bad on defense as far as overall consistency goes. This is a highly, highly volatile team. I think BC got a little excitement about them. The program feeling good because they got Phil back at quarterback. I'm going to trust the more consistent team here. I'm going to take Boston College plus the 2, partly because I don't know why Georgia Tech would be favored over anybody with as bad as their numbers have been. They are number 113 in offensive success rate and number 113 in defensive success rate. They're not really good on either side of the ball, but they can jump up and bite you if you're not paying attention. I think BC is going to be paying attention. So I'll take the Eagles.
Yeah, we're going the same way here on this one. I think Boston College is a better football team. I think they're the better coach team. I think they have more talent. I think they'll have a better quarterback. Everything in which I think is important to winning football games, every one of those edges goes to BC.
I tend to like it. So both rolling Boston College. We've only picked one different so far. Let's move over to another ACC game. Miami headed to Tallahassee to take on Florida State. And Florida State, a 2.5-point home dog. 60.5 is the total. Miami 6-1 against the spread their last 7 in Tallahassee. They are 3-1 against the spread in the last 4 against Florida State. They have won 4 straight outright. Look, you want to look at numbers? Since Tyler Van Dyke came in at quarterback for Miami, they are the number 3 overall efficiency offense in the country. They have been unbelievable. Now, had a couple of turnovers, make things look a little wonky against Georgia Tech last week, but you start looking at yardage numbers and everything else, they dominated the stat sheet against Georgia Tech. They should have won by more last week. But I really like Miami. Florida State has not seen anything like this other than, like, Wake Forest. I'm going to take Miami minus the 2.5 and feel really good about it because I feel in 7.
This is one where everything in me says Miami's the right pick here, but I think Norvell's getting things going right. I think they're going to win a marquee game. It's either going to be this to kind of give them some momentum going into next year. It's either going to be this game or the Florida game. You know, I guess everything in me says it should be the Florida game and not here. But I'm going to take Norvell and the boys.
I can understand that. I mean, it's not like Florida State's been bad, and they should have Jordan Travis back this week. You know, obviously. They had a bunch of flu issues.
They've looked much better. They haven't looked anywhere as close to as good as Miami's looked the last couple of games since making the quarterback change. But they've looked much, much better.
Between the two teams, Florida State and Florida, both of them had guys out with the flu last week. And Florida State still put up a fight against NC State. Like, they were still in that ball game until late. And Florida was just never in the game against South Carolina. Like, you could tell which team was fighting for their coach and which wasn't. So Florida State still got some fight in them. So you're going to take the Noles at plus 2.5. I'm taking Miami minus the 2.5. Let's move on. 7 p.m. Eastern time. We have got Arizona State and Washington. Of course, Jimmy Lake is suspended. The offense coordinator, John Donovan, fired after last week. Washington is a 5.5-point dog at home. 45.5 is the total. Arizona State, this is a team that has been very difficult to figure out this season. Yeah, you just go based on numbers overall on the season. Arizona State is the easy play, and when you toss it in with some of these trends, it's certainly an easy play for me. Arizona State 5-0 against the spread of their last 5 in Seattle, and 5-0 against the spread against Washington overall. They handle Washington. I love the numbers here. I mean, everything points to this being Arizona State by more than a touchdown. I think they take advantage of the situation, so I'm going to roll with Arizona State here.
Man, we're going to agree again. Yeah, I think the same thing. I do not like this Washington team. I haven't liked them all year. There's a world where Jimmy Lake not being their coach makes them better at football because I don't think he's a very good coach. But I don't know. I just don't think they have a whole lot to offer. And the only reason I would even come close to considering Washington is because the drunken path that Arizona State has played through this season.
Exactly.
That's it.
Like, you're betting on chaos.
But this is one of those things where, if you're betting on Washington, you're just betting on chaos. That's exactly right. You're just hoping for the unexpected to happen.
And here's the one thing that I don't think that you can fix this late in the season. Washington against the run, number 115 in EPA per rush, and they are number 112 in defensive success rate against the run. Arizona State is number 8 in EPA per rush on offense, and rushing the ball on offense, they are number 3 in success rate. Like, they know how to run the ball. Washington cannot stop it. I don't foresee them stopping it in this game. So, Arizona State minus 5.5 is the pick for both of us. Let's move to the SEC, and we are going to roll Arkansas at LSU. The Tigers are a 2.5-point dog at home, total of 59. Arkansas 6-2 against the spread in their last 8 games. LSU, however, 5-0 straight up against Arkansas in the last 5. I have got a weird feeling about this, because if you look at numbers overall on the season, obviously you would go with Arkansas here. But LSU showed some fight last week. Coaches said they installed like 8 new defensive looks last week. They did some different things on offense. I like what they're doing. They've got some fight left. Those upperclassmen that are left on the team have some fight. I think they're sick of losing. They're getting this one at home. I think they're going to beat Arkansas. So I'm going to take LSU plus the 2.5. I think LSU's still a good team. They've got more talent left on the team than Arkansas does right now. Arkansas is good, but I think LSU beats them.
Yeah, I agree with that. Everything you said, I think Arkansas is really good. I think they're going to come ready. I think they're going to come prepared. But I think LSU cares about this game, and they got a lot of pride in them. And they're going to fight like hell. It's going to be hard to beat them in Death Valley.
It's a night game.
Still hard to win games.
Yeah.
It's still really hard to win games in Death Valley.
You are not wrong about that. Next game on the docket, 7:30 p.m. Eastern time. NC State heads to Wake Forest. It's an ACC network game because, of course, it is. NC State won this one last year 45-42. And Wake Forest, 11-1 against the spread the last 12 at home against NC State. Of course, that goes back two decades. I mean, forever. It's a long time. Before 2020, Wake was 3-0 against the spread and straight up against NC State. Before that, you start diving into numbers, and you have a really fascinating matchup between Wake's offense and NC State's defense. NC State's defense is awesome. They're number 4 in the country in defensive success rate. You look over at Wake Forest, I mean, number 5 in offensive EPA per play margin. There's a lot to like about this game to figure out who will be able to implement their game plan better. I am going to lean Wake Forest here because I think that at home, especially coming off of their first loss of the season, I think that they are going to be able to outscore NC State, because I don't think NC State's offense is bad, but I also don't think that they'll be able to keep up in this spot, even with their defense slowing down Wake Forest a little bit. So I'll take Wake minus 2.
Well, I let the cat out of the bag on this one earlier when I said this is going to be the most exciting game of the weekend. Wake scoring 50 every week from now until the end of the season. Nobody in that schedule remaining is keeping them under 50. I do not think NC State has the firepower to keep them under 50. And I do not think NC State can come close to scoring 50.
I like it. I like it. We're both rolling Wake minus 2. Got a few more here. TCU heading to Stillwater to take on Oklahoma State. And, of course, the Cowboys, a 13-point favorite, total of 54.5. TCU won this game 29-22 last year. Oklahoma State, 4-1 against the spread at home against TCU in the last 5. And when I look at the numbers here, it's very hard to figure out because I don't know exactly what TCU is after firing Gary Patterson. They really swapped up some stuff last week. They are not running as much on early downs. They went a little more pass-heavy. Chandler Morris looks very competent at quarterback. That's not to say that Max Duggan was bad. Obviously, the TCU offense has been pretty good. But also, the defense for TCU was able to cause a little bit of havoc. They ran some different stuff. I really thought that this line would be closer to like 7 or 8, and instead it's 13. So you would think that I would roll the other direction, but because it kind of stinks to me, I think I'm going to roll with Oklahoma State. I'm going to take the Cowboys minus 13. Chandler Morris, still a freshman quarterback. Last week was his first start. It was at home. Now he gets to go on the road for the first time. And you know Stillwater is going to be a buzzsaw. So I'm going to take Oklahoma State to shut down that TCU offense and get a pretty big win here. Because I think now that everybody's healthy for Oklahoma State, Gundy's offense has been putting up points lately. So I think they're going to put up points here.
Oklahoma State is the best team in the Big 12. I do not think it is close, by the way. I don't. I know a lot of Oklahoma fans aren't going to like hearing that, but that's the truth. And I think they're going to destroy, systematically take apart TCU. Here's what I think happened. This is how I'm explaining last week with Baylor. And I think this explains it exactly the way it is, exactly the way it happened. And that is simply Baylor was looking forward to Oklahoma. Baylor was looking ahead because TCU looked like a dead fish out of water. And they thought, if we get Oklahoma, it changes our season. And there's no way they could ever envision losing to TCU.
Yeah, I tend to agree with that. Those look-aheads, I mean, it's sometimes tough, right? It's tough to not get people fired up about games that are coming up in the future and paying attention to what you're doing right now, especially with a newer head coach and some fresh faces on the roster. So, yeah, I could totally understand it. So you're going to ride Oklahoma State as well, minus 13 there, and we got a few more. We got some late-night games here, 10:30 p.m. Eastern time. We are heading over to Nevada at San Diego State. I love this game. San Diego State is a 3-point favorite, total of 45.5. Nevada won last year 26-21. Nevada 3-0 straight up and against the spread the last three seasons against San Diego State. And you start diving into this. Nevada's defense is not good. But San Diego State has trouble scoring against air. Like, they're not good on offense. They need the other team to make mistakes and give them short fields and whatnot. And, of course, obviously, San Diego State got the best player on the field with the punter, Matt Areza. Either way, when I look at the defense against Nevada's offense, I do believe San Diego State is going to slow them down. But Nevada has so many different ways to score. And any mistake that San Diego State makes is going to cost them. I'm going to ride with Nevada because I've got a 3-point head start here. But this certainly looks like it's a game that could come down to the wire. And I trust the team that can score over the one that can't. So I'll take the Wolfpack here.
I've been staying on San Diego State all year. It's been pretty good for the most part. I'm gonna stay on them. They find ways to win games. They find ways to manufacture points. And you know, I don't know if they're gonna do it through defense. I don't know if they're gonna do it through, you know, turnovers or how it's gonna come. But I think they find a way to get just enough.
That totally makes sense. I mean, the way that they would be able to do this is, I mean, they're number 53 in EPA per rush on offense and number 119 on defense for Nevada in that EPA per rush metric. So there is a sizable mismatch there. There is no mismatch for Nevada's offense against San Diego State's defense. They're good at everything. But I do know that Nevada got the best quarterback on the field. That's the way I'm going to go. Nevada plus 3. You are rolling San Diego State minus 3. 10:30 p.m. Eastern time. We have got Utah State and San Jose State. And the reason I'm bringing this up is Nick Starkel came back and started playing last week. I thought that this line would be Utah State minus 4. And instead, San Jose State came out and was favored by 4. Now they're up to 4.5, total of 57.5. They last met in 2018, so none of that crap really matters, other than the fact that Utah State is 8-0 straight up and 7-1 against the spread in their last 8 against San Jose State. That was before Brent Brennan really got this thing rolling with the Spartans here. With Nick Starkel back and everything else, you would think it would boost me a little bit on San Jose State. But, man, when I look at what Blake Anderson's done, he and Logan Bonner have really turned this thing around. Utah State is 7-2 straight up this year. They are rocking. And I think they're going to continue rocking, even on the road here. San Jose State's got the better defense, but... but I think Utah State finds ways to score. I'm going to take Utah State plus the 4.5 here. They're not as talented as San Jose State, which is a weird thing to say these days, but I think they're the better football team. So I'm going to take the Aggies.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think they got a chance to win this game. I really do. And that would be a massive, massive win for Blake Anderson and Utah State.
They have
got to take the points as well.
They've got a shot to win 10 games this year. Like, it blows my mind looking at this. But they have got a shot to do it. They've got the offense to be able to do this. That team is playing well together. They've got a lot of good chemistry. The last game on the board before we get out of here, we have got 10:30 p.m. Eastern Time, Washington State. The Cougars headed to Eugene, Oregon to take on the Ducks. And the Ducks are a 14-point favorite, total of 57.5. Last year, Oregon won this game 43-29. Even with losing their coach, even with Rolovich and all those other guys gone, Washington State continues to fight week in and week out. Jake Dickert has done a good job as the interim head coach. Washington State 5-0 against the spread in their last five games. They are 5-0 against the spread in their last five at Eugene. And they are 9-1 against the spread overall in the last 10 against Oregon. Like, they always show up against the Ducks for whatever reason. You start diving into numbers, it's easy to get sucked into some of this Oregon stuff. But honestly, like, Oregon is just kind of middle of the road, you know, nothing crazy for them. I think Washington State fights. Like, I think they are still in the Pac-12 race. So I will certainly take Washington State plus the 14 here, because I think Oregon just wants to make sure that they are healthy and they get out of town with a win because they got Utah next week. So give me the Cougars plus 14.
I like the Cougars plus 14. I will have some money on the Cougars money line. I think they can win this game. Oregon, just like Oklahoma, they have not been impressive. They have been winning by the hair of the chinny chin chin. And it's just one of those things, at some point in time, one of these teams going to get up there and get them.
Now, you certainly got that right. You have certainly got that right. You never know what's going to happen in these Pac-12 games, especially Pac-12 after dark, because, again, 10:30 p.m. Eastern Time kickoff. So you and I both riding with the Cougars.